Morning, everyone. I extend a warm wishes from the webinar desk of the Department of English, Govindamal Adityanar College for Women, Tiruchentur. Govindamal Adityanar College is the first self-financing college in Thoothukudi district, established by Adityanar Educational Institution in the year 1987 with the lofty idea of spreading higher education to the rural masses. Our college has the academic credit of securing many university ranks continuously from its establishment. We offer undergraduate courses, postgraduate courses, research level courses, and various certificate courses. On this August occasion, I thank our chairman, Sir S. Balasubramanian Adithan, for rendering the permission to organize a webinar on climate literature and introduction. A life without nature doesn't have a bright future, and every season has its own reason. According to Stanley Horowitz, winter is an etching, spring a watercolor, summer an oil painting, and autumn a mosaic of them all. To know something more about climate, today we are here with sharp ears to enjoy a webinar on climate literature and introduction. Now, I request Dr. R. Anjal, convener and head of the Department of English, to deliver welcome address. Over to Anjal, ma'am.
Good morning, everybody. A pleasant good morning, everybody. I deem it a great pleasure and privilege in delivering my welcome speech. First and foremost, I'd like to welcome our reputed and beloved principal, Madam Dr. P. Jayanti, who is the backdrop of all our success, and she's a tower of strength to all of us. Next, I extend my warm welcome to our chief guest, Dr. Benison, who is the assistant professor in St. John's College, Palayankottai. To put it in a nutshell about him, he is a man of encyclopedic knowledge, yeah, and is having oceanic knowledge, and he is a man with kaleidoscopic potentialities and caliber. He is guiding so many research scholars, and his articles were published in recognized foreign journals. But he is a very simple and humble man. When he was talking with me yesterday, he told me that this topic would be giving only simple points. I'll be talking in a simple manner. So saying, he has become a mighty person. When Gandhiji was given the title Mahatma by Rabindranath Tagore, Mahatma Gandhi said, "I am not a Mahatma, I am an Alpatma." So saying, he had become Mahatma. So also, our resource person has become the Mahatma of the literary world, saying that was a simple man, he has become a mighty person. And he has chosen a very novel topic, climate literature. We are very eager to hear new points from him. We are all the participants are sharpening our ears to hear a lot from him, to know a lot from him. And once again, I give you a red carpet welcome, sir. In the midst of your multifarious work, you have agreed to be the resource person for our program. Thank you very much, sir. And once again, I welcome you. Next, I would like to extend my welcome to our Vice Principal, Madam Dr. Shendavalli, HOD of Economics Department, who will be an embodiment of encouragement to me in all walks of my life. And I heartily welcome the program coordinators, Dr. G. Jayalakshmi and Dr. C.K. Umadevi, who are two pillars of our department and who have done lion's share of help for me for the success of this webinar. I welcome heartily Literary Association Staff Secretary Serin Satya and also the co-organizer, A. Selvalakshmi, who have done a lot for the success of this webinar. I'm getting immense pleasure in welcoming all the staff members of our college and non-teaching staff members of our college and everyone from our college. I derive divine pleasure in welcoming all the professors of various colleges All the research scholars belong to various colleges, and my beloved students of our college and various colleges. I give a special welcome to the reputed teachers of various schools. I welcome all the elders and youngsters. I obtain everlasting ecstasy and perennial pleasure in welcoming each and every participant of this webinar. I once again welcome one and all. Thank you very much. Now over to Sarin Satya.
Thank you, ma'am, for your warm welcome. Though our resource person needs no introduction, still it's a pleasure to honor him with an introductory note. So I request our program coordinator and assistant professor of English, Dr. C.K. Uma Devi, to introduce the resource person. Over to Uma, ma'am.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Uma Devi, assistant professor of English and the coordinator of this webinar on the title Climate Literature and Introduction. I deem it a great pleasure and privilege to introduce our resource person, Dr. B. Benison, Associate Professor of English at John's College, Padukkottai. He is a very talented teacher and a very good friend of mine. I feel so proud and happy for having him as our chief guest today. He has more than 30 years of experience in teaching. He has done his doctorate research on the topic Image of Woman in the novels of Anita Desai. Till now, he has attended more than 10 orientation and refresher courses and more than 90 seminars, conferences, workshops, FTPs, etc. He has organized and chaired nearly 30 seminars, conferences, and workshops. He has presented a number of research articles in various national and international seminars and conferences, and his papers got published in many national and international journals. He has served as a resource person for more than 100 meetings, seminars, workshops, conferences, etc. Under his guidance and supervision, a number of MPhil scholars completed their Master of Philosophy in a very successful manner, and two PhD scholars received their doctoral degree. One scholar has submitted his thesis, and two other scholars are going to submit their thesis very soon. Then, his contribution to e-journals is remarkable. He has been serving as a proofreader for Bio Research Bulletin and e-journal and managing editor for TJLS, the Journal for English Language and Literary Studies, an international peer-reviewed quarterly journal for many years. We are very happy and proud to have such a man of high academic excellence as our resource person today. Now he is going to treat us with his literary feast. On behalf of our Department of English, I extend a warm welcome to you, sir. Now it is the time for you for our literary feast.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. Greetings to each and every one of you. I'm not worthy enough to receive the words of the head of the department, Dr. Arnar, and from the words of from the mouth of Dr. Uma. I'm still a student of English language and literature. I am still a student. What I have read from here and there, I'm presenting to you. That's all. That's all. Some of you might be very familiar with the phrase climate literature. Some of you might have joined us to know more about climate literature, and a few of you might have come here to listen to know what is climate literature, what climate literature is. I'll do my best. It's very simple. I accept, I acknowledge the presence of each and every one of you here this morning. With a heart full of thanks to Dr. Arnar, the head of the department, thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the opportunity. My good friend, Dr. Uma, I know her for more than 20 years. and Serene Satya, one of my good students of my wife. All of you are here, the whole department. I bow before you as a student of English language and literature. Right, over to the topic. Let me tell you in the beginning itself that I am talking to the students, not to the scholars, not to the teachers, because I will be concentrating more on the basics of climate literature. I came to know about this terminology, climate literature, very recently from a good friend of mine, Mr. Selvin, who is in Tuticorin. He's a voracious reader, and whatever the book you ask him, he'll be able to get it for you. He introduced me. On the other hand, I was interested in, and still I am interested in, eco-criticism. So when I came to know about climate literature, I was fascinated towards this title, and I was drawn to this to read a little. Now, this may be an introduction to a few of my friends who are sitting in front of me. This is just an introduction. That's why I put the title in this way, Climate Literature, an Introduction. We are living in a world of evolutions and revolutions. Every day we are getting new things. Yesterday I was in a university. I'm a part of the research committee there. I was in the doctoral committee. At that time, one madam came to introduce her topic in ELT. One of the experts who happened to be with me said, ELT is oft worked and more worked area. If you don't finish your thesis on time, your thesis will be considered to be an out-of-date one. So that is how this world is emerging, with lots and lots of new theories, new areas in every field, whether it's science or arts or whatever the discipline you call it, medicine or whatever it could be. Every day, new things are coming up. In the beginning, when we were students a few years ago, maybe three decades ago, there are only a few areas to be spoken about in English literature. Chaucer's age, they were divided according to the ages. Elizabethan age, Jacobean age, Puritan age, it keeps on going, right? Then 20th century literature. Now we have the term contemporary literature. In the 20th century, the literary field burst out and it invited very many different areas and theories to be formed. So in the later part of the 20th century, and in the beginning of the 21st century, literature has found new areas to excavate, to go deep into it, to explore, and to find new things there. Now you can understand the last two lines of Ulysses, not to yield. We are going to get more and more areas, new areas in literary studies. Based on the centuries, era, or period, literature was divided. But now, based on the themes, literature is divided. Based on the structure, based on the content, literature is divided. So that's why every day we are getting new and new areas to research. In application of successful or scientifically accepted general principles to explain a phenomena, that is theory, it has found many areas to fix on. What are they? Now, 20 years ago, Dr. Nirmal Selvamani, my teacher in Madras Christian College, he retired from the Central University of Tiruvallur. He introduced me eco-criticism. He developed a taste on that particular theory, criticism, eco-criticism. When he introduced me eco-criticism, only a few branched out areas from eco-criticism was available. But now we have very many areas, very many theories emerged from eco-criticism. And these theories are really quite interesting to know and to dwell into, but at the same time, they are not permanent. That's why we have climate literature. 40 or 50 years ago, we had, maybe 30 years ago, 40 years ago, we had modernism, we had colonialism, we had structuralism, all in the literary theories. Now, we have post-structural, post-modern, post-feminism, so something like that. Very recently, when I was attending a program, the resource person was referring to the post-modern theory as post-postmodern theory, post-post-colonialism. So now we are living in the post-post world. So in this world, now we have climate literature. What is this climate literature all about? That's what we are going to see. I am going to say one sentence. Please, this is someone has said, you can understand this, you can keep this in your mind. The written text has no specific life. The written text has no life in it. Yes, as written, as we read, we don't see any life in it. But when a tool is applied to it, when a theory is applied to it, we see life in it. That's why in the entrance of Cambridge University, it has been written as Shakespeare is our contemporary. What a beautiful sentence it is. It's really beautiful. Shakespeare is our contemporary. Shakespeare is still alive, though he wrote his plays several centuries ago. He is our contemporary. Postmodern theories are now being applied to Shakespeare's plays. A written text has no life unless and until a theory is applied to it. We can argue any part of a work or any work from any point of view with a theory and give life to it. That is why the green studies, eco-literature, climate literature, they all seem to be one and the same. All the theories could be applied to one particular work of art, and every work of art could be understood from that particular theoretical point of view. Now I'm going to introduce you climate literature, which is also the other forms of eco-literature or green literature or environmental literature, but it has something different to say. We will see that in the last. Now we will enter into the slideshow. Can Madam Uma, please? Can you share the slide, please?
Okay, sir.
Yes, please.
Chat, sir?
Yes, please.
No, okay.
No, it is not shared.
Not shared. So now, is it okay?
No, I'm not able to. Ma'am, is it visible for you? I'm not able to see the slides here.
Thanks,
now, if it is visible on your side, then okay.
Wait, sir.
Now it is good.
Okay, sir.
Can you make it a full screen one? I see only the slide here. If it could be, from the beginning or something like that.
Sir, now is it okay?
Okay, right. Let me go ahead with this. Is it clear? Is it visible on your side?
Yes, sir.
Then okay, let me begin. Climate literature. Go to the next slide, please. What is climate literature? This literature speaks about the relationship between people and the environment. Of course, it has long been documented through literary verse. Take for example, even in Tinai concept, we have climate. Based on the land alone, it has been land, water, mountain. We have the Tinai concept, but climate also plays a vital role there. When we talk about the climate, we can trace the origin from the Holy Bible and from Odyssey, natural discourse toward eco-composition, written by Edward White. He cites that Adam and Eve's journey through the Garden of Eden and Odyssey's dangerous trek across the Mediterranean Sea in Homer's Odyssey, or as early literary examples in which human paths cross with nature. So climate literature is nothing but a literature that speaks about the relationship between the people and the environment. We should keep this in our mind first. It is nothing but the literary works that speak about the people, the relationship between the people and the environment. The next it speaks, I want to give you an introduction to eco-criticism. Next slide, please. Eco-criticism is nothing but the green studies. Go to the next slide, please. Eco-criticism is nothing but the green studies. It is a distinct rise in environmental writing and its importance. It first got its origin in American culture in the 18th and early 19th century. But this term, as you know, was first coined by William Rucket in the year 1978 in his essay, Literature and Ecology, an Experiment in Eco-Criticism. But before that, my friends, we must be very happy and we must be proud to say that this ecology concerned, eco or environment related literary pieces are found in Tinai concept several centuries ago. So we can be very proud to call ourselves as that we are the pioneers. Come to the next slide. Eco-criticism is to experiment with the application of ecology and ecological concepts. Even when I'm talking to you, you can read the lines that you see on the slide. So it is the study of literature. It is the study of ecology. It is the study of the experience that the writers have had while writing. And it is the record of the ecological concepts to be read, to be taught, and to be written about that particular literature. So this is one aspect. Okay, fine, go to the next slide. To sum up, ecocriticism, it investigates, listen to me this, to this word, it investigates the relationships between literature and the physical environment. There ends ecocriticism, but climate literature is something different. We will see that later. Ecocriticism is earth-centered because it is closely related to Gaia, the Mother Earth. The simple concept in ecocriticism is, if you disturb nature, then nature will in turn disturb you. It's very simple. So it is the record of the self, the society, nature, and the texts acquired from the experience. It investigates the ways, but climate literature is something different. Go to the next slide, please. The climate literature, next slide, please, recognizes the reality of climate change. That is the first and the foremost thing that we need to keep in our mind. Eco-criticism or green literature, eco-literature, I'm sorry, or green literature or environmental literature, they speak about the relationship between people and the environment. Again and again, I talk about Tinai concept. Sea and the areas that are related to sea. Kurji, Mullai, Palai, right? Okay. The mountain, the people who lived in the mountain side and the areas that are related to the mountain. Desert and the areas that are related to the relationship. But climate literature speaks about the reality of climate change. It bridges the wide gap between our short-term thinking and decision-making and the resulting long-term environmental consequences. Look at the word, long-term environmental consequences. So we have already seen that what ecocriticism is. Ecocriticism, the simple concept is, if you disturb nature, nature will in turn disturb you. Fine. That's all. There ends. So climate literature is an extension of that. The concept of the climate literature has the extension of something which ends there with ecoliterature. That is, it speaks about the environmental consequences. It speaks about the climatically changed world. The translation of abstract future into individual life stories and the reconnection between actions and impacts are recorded in the climate literature. How? Terry Dam, when Terry Dam was built, lakhs and lakhs of trees were destroyed. Now in Karnataka, they are planning to build a dam. A few days ago, I read in the Hindu Tamil newspaper that more than 1 lakh trees will be cut down. So automatically the climate will be disturbed. In Tuticorin itself, because of the presence of too many factories there, the rainfall, the measurement, the rainfall has gone down. So it disturbs the whole climate. And further we go to the next one. This climate literature records the past, records the present, and sometimes it records the future also. There are a few movies, some of you who are present here might have seen that those movies. Those movies, they speak destruction or the whole change that the earth is going to experience because of the melt, the glaciers that are found in the oceans on the poles, two poles. They melt and most of the land, the areas are swallowed by the water. So they speak about future, what will happen, and they become inseparably intertwined. Yes, the record of things from the past in the present for the future are seen as inseparably intertwined, and thereby they highlight the dangers of tomorrow. The dangers of tomorrow. I want to play a video now. I request the organizers to play the first video. There the earth speaks.
The okay, earth sir. Speaks. Okay.
The mother speaks. Let's watch that.
First.
Some call me nature. Others call me Mother Nature. I've been here for over 4.5 billion years. 22,500 times longer than you. I don't really need people, but people need me. Yes, your future depends on me. When I thrive, you thrive. When I falter, you falter. Or worse. But I've been here for eons. I have fed species greater than you, and I have starved species greater than you. My oceans, my soil, my flowing streams, my forests, they all can take you or leave you. How you choose to live each day, whether you regard or disregard me, doesn't really matter to me, one way or the other. Your actions will determine your fate, not mine. I am nature. I will go on. I am prepared to evolve. Are you?
What a beautiful sentence. Look how it works. Nature doesn't need people, but people need nature. So in continuation of the eco-criticism, green literature, eco-literature, environment literature, if you disturb nature, nature will in turn disturb you. So in continuation of that, it says that nature doesn't need man, but man needs nature. Man needs nature. So that's why it is said, the past is there, the present is there, and the future is also there. And the future is also there. So this is told, this is portrayed, and this is made legible. Go to the next slide, please. What is climate literature and why? The climate literature is nothing but an annihilation of environmental time, destruction of environmental time. The time has been fully changed. Say in Tamil, I would like to say one or two sentences. வயல்ல விதை விதைத்து நாற்று நட்டு நெல் அறுத்த காலங்கள் மாறிவிட்டது. உளுந்து விதைத்த காலங்கள் மாறிவிட்டது. The period has been changed from one month to the other. The season is changed. We call it the season. It is nothing but the annihilation of environmental time. You read the quotation that I've quoted there. Barbara Dam at Adam describes environmental time as latency. I have given you the meaning also. The state of existing but not yet, right? The immanence, pace and intensity, contingency, and context dependence, time distanciation, and intergenerational impacts, rhythmicity and time scales of change, timing and tempo, transience and transcendence, irreversibility and indeterminacy. Look at this. Look at the words Barbara Adam has used there. And this is the core, this is the gist of climate literature. Climate literature speaks about the past in the present for the future. It is a kind of a warning that is, it is a kind of a warning that is given to the readers like you and me. Many literary pieces have been produced based on this. So that is why when we read literature, when I conclude, you would know how I conclude, because that I want to give you a clarion call. Yes, please listen to that, wait till the end. So the dangers are always there. We have disturbed, science has disturbed in the name of the advancement in scientific inventions and discoveries. We have disturbed the harmony between the human beings and the nature. That's why we have climate literature. Go to the next slide, please. Therefore, the environmental time encompasses those taken for granted, look at the phrase, taken for granted processes and transformations of nature, which others remain undetected by the human eye. You might have seen the street sides, people setting fire to the debris there, waste papers, plastics are there, they are burnt down to ashes. No, they are not burnt down to ashes. They create havoc to the atmosphere. They are not seen by the human eye. We cannot see them. We cannot understand what is actually going on there. We use asbestos sheets. They are very dangerous to our health. They are carcinogenic by nature. We use the powdered materials as ceiling, as false ceiling. We call them the plaster of Paris. But people say that due to heat, they burst into particles, they remain in the room. And when we inhale, the powder goes into our lungs, they create havoc there. They bring danger to our lungs, our respiratory systems. Throughout the land, in our area, Parthenium is found everywhere. It's all because of the human effort. That's why climate literature speaks about and encompasses the taken for granted activities of the human beings. Ultimately, the understanding of time enforces the dualistic division between nature and culture. You read that fast, please. Adam in Time's Cap says, time has become the invisible other that works outside and beyond the reach of our senses. We use mosquito repellent. Yeah, no other way. That's because of the presence of the mosquitoes in our camp, in our rooms. They disturb us. All these small things, they disturb in a very, very huge way. Go to the next slide, please. Rob Nixon, in his Slow Violence and Environmentalism of the Poor, points to the representational challenges of making slow environmental time appear again and again. Look at the word time is there. Time is there. He employs the term slow violence. Look at this word, phrase, slow violence. We spoil the atmosphere, we cut the tree, we burn so many things. We have factories in our places that emit poisonous gases. In order to describe these things, you see, slow violence, in order to describe a kind of violence that is not sensational, but occurs gradually. So climate literature presents these things, record these things. Go to the next slide, please. in the late 2000, that is maybe now, right now we can say 1990s or so, climate change impacts became more evident. Yes, every day we read in the news, the disappearing of the ice mountains, the in the Arctic and the Antarctic oceans, and because of that, the rise of the water level. So many things are happening. They become more evident, and their public concern intensified in the literature. Yes, more than dozens of English language novels are published. And some of the novelists I have mentioned there, Margaret Atwood, Barbara Kingsolver, Amitav Ghosh, Ian McEwan, Cormac McCarthy, David Mitchell, and King Stanley Robinson. Go to the next slide, please. Scholars, you know, scholars of environmental communication and environmental psychology have argued that arts can play, look at this word phrase, arts can play a critical role in influencing beliefs, attitudes, and behaviors related to climate change. What does it mean? Written forms, painted forms, sculptures can change the beliefs of the people. It can bring a change in the minds of the people, those who run into it. Gobert and Clark, they argue that the arts, the so-called invisibility of climate change to be seen, felt, and imagined in the present and the future. These literary pieces encourage critical reflection on the existing social structures and cultural and moral norms. Look at this section. They encourage encourage critical reflection and on existing social structure and cultural and moral norms. Till in 1980s or 90s, the windmills were not seen in larger in number in our Tamil Nadu, in our area, in Tuticorin district and also in Tirunelveli district. But now they are found in very huge number. No, you know what they did, how they disturb? They drive away the clouds that bring rain to our places. They drive away. They blow away, okay? Many reptiles are missing in those places. Foxes, the rabbits, mice, they have disappeared from such places. That they have disturbed the climate, they have disturbed the earth as well. Go to the next slide, please. That is the social structure. You might have noticed the change that I have given there in the title. What is climate literature and why? In between climate and literature, I have put the word fiction inserted. Most of the climate literature are in the form of fiction. There are a few poetic presentation, right? Poetry are there, but climate literature, when we talk about, when we say climate literature, we see fiction there more in number. All these fictional works, they speak about the impact on pro-environmental behaviors. Particularly, they speak about the influence of the theoretical fields such as eco-criticism, and it's not just, we have been talking about that for many times. Look at the last point. Climate literature reflects nature, sustainability, climate change, and responsibility. Go to the next place. That's why it is commonly known as cli-fi. I have formed this hyphenated word, CLI-LIT, climate is my own coinage, my own presentation. Climate fiction is a common one. It is climate literature is narrowed down to climate fiction. Climate lit is a common, I have introduced that. Fine. Now you would ask a question, what is the difference between the science fiction and the climate fiction, or science fiction or science literature and climate literature? Climate literature or climate fiction is nothing but a branch of science fiction. It's nothing but a branch of science fiction. So climate fiction, go to the next slide, please. Climate fiction depicts a future world completely altered by climate change. Completely altered by climate change. Madam, please play the second video clip. It speaks about the climate change. What would happen if climate changes?
I understand.
Please watch this.
When you get a virus, you get a fever. That's the human body raising its core temperature to kill the virus. Planet Earth works the same way. Global warming is the fever. Mankind is the virus. We're making our planet sick. A cold is our only hope. If we don't reduce our population ourselves, there's only one of two ways this can go. The host kills the virus, or the virus kills the host. Either way,
the result is the same. The virus dies.
So Valentine's going to take care of the population problem himself.
Well, if we don't do something, nature will. Sometimes a culling is the only way to ensure that the species survives. And history will see Valentine as the man who saved humanity from extinction.
So this is a simple thing. Look at the villain says, man becomes a virus. When virus enters into the body of man, it gives heat in his body. And this virus is spread throughout the world. This increases the global warming. So what should we do? We should decrease the population. So the heat could be, in order to decrease the population, in order to decrease the global warming and also the effect of global warming and also the climatic changes that this world experiences, we should decrease the population of the Earth. Look at the equation that this villain speaks about, gives. So ultimately, when climate changes, recently in China, I read in the newspaper that for more than 1,000 years, China has not experienced this kind of cloud burst. People say that this is all because of the climate changes. China has built one of the biggest dams in the world in the highest altitude. And people say that that itself disturbs the climate in that area. So climate fiction is all about the climate that this world has experienced, the climate changes. And it speaks about the contemporary worries. It speaks about the contemporary worries that are expressed. How, and also it speaks about the ways to find a solution. So climate can be seen as a safe space as well. Yes. As a safe space, it speaks about the reason for the climatic changes, it speaks about the solution for the changes, and also the problems the world faces. So that's what we should understand from the climate fiction. There are a few climate fiction I have mentioned here. You can make a note of it. Madam, please go to the slide after the next. Next one. You see the list of Herzog's, that's it, Herzog's Heat that came in 2003, Bruce Sterling's Heavy Weather, and the Caryatids in the year 2009, T.C. Boyle's A Friend of the Earth, Crichton's State of Fear, King Stanley Robbins's Signs in the Capital Trilogy, it came in 2004, 5 and 7, Aurora in 2015. Okay, you can read, you can read. Go to the next slide, please. All you find the list of novels or fiction that came from America, American literature. Okay, you can read them fast. You can read them fast. If you want, you can even take a screenshot if you've got some interest in reading the climate literature. You can make a note of that. Barbara Kingsolver's Flight Behavior, Nathaniel Rich's Odds Against Tomorrow in 2013, William Gibson's The Peripheral in 2014, Shang Lee's On Such a Fallacy in 2014, Ben Lerner's 10:04 in 2015, and the list goes on. Go to the next slide, please, ma'am. There is one graphic novel. Josh Neufels has written that, with the title New Orleans After the Deluge in 2010. Grand Culliff and Eric Eisner's H2O in 2013. Brainwood's The Massive. So there are three or four novels there. Come to the next slide. There are a few films available in the net. Very interesting films, they are available. You can make a note of them. Darren Aronofsky's Nova, very interesting one. You saw a clipping, that was from Kingsman. My daughter gave this title. That is from Kingsman, K-I-N-G-S-M-A-N, Kingsman. It's an action comedy. So the solution to reduce the population is to spread virus, and the virus will bring fever. The fever will increase the global warming. And when the population is reduced, when the population is brought down, the villain says, automatically, global warming will be controlled. In Tamil, we have a beautiful movie, Thannir Thannir. Thannir Thannir, K. Balachandra's Thannir Thannir. It's a beautiful movie. We have many, many, in addition to the list that I have given you, Boyle's A Friend of the Earth. It speaks about the end of the world. It's a movie, A Friend of the Earth. A Friend of the Earth. Then The Ice Lovers, another movie. Steve O'Brien, a British writer, has written 1975 for Zakaria. Then Kate Wilkins, Where Late the Sweet Birds Sang. So the list goes on. They all speak about, you must keep this in your mind, that climate literature speaks about the future, speaks about the past in the present for the future. What could be the result? The dangers of disturbing nature. And also climate literature gives us a solution for that. Go to the next slide, please. There are a few novels, fictions there from British literature. You can read, you can take a screenshot, or if you want, you can even make a note of it. Go to the next slide, please. Ben Elton's Time and Time Again. There's a film there, Matthew Vaughn's Kingsman, The Secret Service. Now we were talking about that. Kingsman, The Secret Service. They call it The Secret Service. How they disturb the human beings, how and why they call it the king's, it's a secret service. Go to the next one. I have given you a list of French climate fiction. Translations are also available. Go to the next one. Now, why on this area we are talking about? Why do we talk about climate fiction? Why? Because climate fiction speak about the anticipated condition of the Anthropocene. The anticipated condition of the Anthropocene. Anthropocene is as much cultural. Anthropocene is nothing but man's own activity that distracts the surroundings. It's his own effort, his own activity that affects the surroundings. Look at this. Anthropocene is as much cultural way of life as it is geological, and in effect records the tensions between culture and geology and what is at stake. That is permanent. And granular violence, small, tiny, insignificant violence caused to nature. Climate fiction represents the depletion of bodies, the destruction, the removal, the disturbances that are given to the climate, the natural climate. We read climate fiction because the abstract futurism itself is post-apocalyptic. You know what what apocalyptic is. And this one, this climate literature fiction is post-apocalyptic. And these scenarios would not be able to stay with the trouble of the present precariousness. So change is inevitable. Nothing is permanent. If once the climate is disturbed, if once the season is disturbed, if once the natural process is disturbed, if once the God-given background or the surroundings or nature is disturbed, the disturbance keeps on going like ripples. So change is inevitable. Go to the next slide. The present day environmental catastrophes and their impact on the precariat of those historically and habitually subject to the environmental injustice. Look at this phrase, environmental injustice, of the fast and slow violence, it's said by Nixon, of climate change. Very slowly. Now, if you go to Trichandur from Tinnavelly, in the name of widening the road, hundreds and hundreds of trees are being cut down. In the name of widening the road from Tinnavelly to Tenkasi, thousands of trees have been rooted out. According to the modern, or we are in the modern world, we have so many modern technologies. The branches could be cut down, but the tree along with the trunk could be removed from its root and it could be planted in some other place. We could have saved 100-year-old trees. But when trees are removed, automatically the climate is disturbed. When a river is, the direction of a river is changed, it disturbs the climate and it disturbs the natural process. So that's why he says it is a slow violence. It is nothing but a slow violence. Go to the next slide. I'm going to finish now. I have quoted it from the Holy Bible. What the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten. What the young locusts have left, other locusts have eaten. Excuse me. I said in the previous slide that Excuse me. Sorry. I said that it is a perennial disturbance. Climate fiction speaks about the perennial disturbance. Eco-literature speaks about the relationship between the man and the nature, between man and the nature, between human beings and the nature. It speaks about the glorious things. In romantic literature, we see nature at the center, man venerating nature, glorifying nature, worshiping nature. Man saw God in the form of nature. Man saw God in nature. In eco-literature, man speaks about the relationship between nature and man. Climate fiction speaks about the disturbances that man has brought to nature and nature's disturbance to man, and also gives the solution for that. Look at this verse from the Bible. One disturbance that man has brought to nature disturbs the other. One destruction brings another destruction. The whole biological cycle is disturbed. The whole system is disturbed if man disturbs nature, because nature takes care of the climate fiction. Come to the next slide, the last slide. We are the gardeners. We are the gardeners in the God's vineyard. The God's vineyard. Go back to the previous slide. You want me to finish? Yeah. Next slide. Yes. We are the gardeners in the God's vineyard. I have quoted the eternal verse from the Holy Bible. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. Man was created from the soil. He will go back to the soil, go back to the earth. In creation, man was put at the center of the earth. That is, Eden was a beautiful garden. Four rivers were there to make it fertile. So pleasant to live there. God put him there in the Garden of Eden to work it. God did not put him there to destroy it, disturb it. God put mankind there to take care of it, to preserve it, to protect it, to cultivate it. But what is going on here in the name of advancement, modern scientific inventions, discoveries, and modernization, industrialization, we are disturbing the whole earth. We are disturbing the climate. We are disturbing our environment. Climate fiction speaks about man's relationship with nature. Climate fiction speaks about man's own anthropocenic activities, that is, the destructive activities voluntarily he does to nature, voluntarily he causes unto nature, and also climate fiction gives a solution for such problems. I hope that you enjoyed and you got at least a glimpse of what climate literature is. Now, over to the organizers.
Participants can post your questions in the chat box.
Someone has something to do.
But till now, there is no question in the chat box, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Simon has beautifully said that environmental injustice would reap their consequences. Thank you.
Yes.
Madam Aishwarya, asked a question. If you could please elaborate more on the concept of environmental time. Yes, ma'am, it is nothing but the season. It is nothing but the season. There is a season to reap, there is a season to sow. There is a reason to sow, and there is a season to reap. So for everything, there is a season. So that is the time, environmental time. We have winter, summer, okay? So in this way, it is divided. Thank you, Madam Sindhija. Thank you, Mr. Madam Ruby.
So thank you very much, sir. It was quite enlightening, and we enjoyed it.
Just a minute. Well, there's a beautiful sentence here from one Mr. or Miss Biswajit Mohanta. Witnessing bizarre consequences of climatic change disorders would be perhaps more severe in the future. That is what climate change, climate literature speaks about. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. It's your time, please.
Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful performance. And we are in seventh heaven with your informative lecture. Expressing gratitude is a part and parcel of one's life. And now it's time to hear the oath of thanks.
Yes,
I, Mr. Satya, Organizing Secretary and Assistant Professor of English, I deem it a great privilege to express oath of thanks on this precious occasion. First of all, I pay my obeisance to the Almighty Lord for his omnipresence throughout the webinar. Then I thank the management for rendering this wonderful opportunity to organize a webinar on climate literature and introduction. Next, I express my gratitude to the resource person, Dr. Bibenison, Associate Professor of English, St. John's College, Palayamkottai, who shared his precious knowledge with us. The way he handled the session is really awesome, and the lecture he delivered is thought-provoking. Thank you very much, sir, for your fabulous presentation. Personally, I thank Dr. Bibenison and his wife, Dr. Vanilla, the teacher of mine, for they are the reasons behind my first publication of POM. I would like to thank our principal and patron, Dr. P. Jayanti, for her encouragement and support. I thank our convener and head of the department, Dr. R. Ondor, for her role is invaluable and quite appreciable. I thank our program coordinators, Dr. G. Jayalakshmi and Dr. C.K. Umadevi, for their guidance and arrangements to make this webinar a grand success. I thank Mrs. Selva Lakshmi, co-organizer and assistant professor of English, for designing the certificate. Then I thank Gayatri for her help in technical side. I also thank my colleagues and other helping hands. Without the presence of the participants, the sessions might have ended up as a match without spectators. So I thank all the participants from various institutions. Once again, I thank you all.
So I would like to say big thanks to all the participants here who have been with us for the past 1 hour, 1 hour and 15 minutes. Thank you so much for your presence, my dear participants. I could see a few of my friends here on the other side. I hope that I have motivated you to turn towards this climate literature. In the days to come, you would certainly read at least one or two literary works on climate literature. So all these three, eco-literature, environment literature, and climate literature, they all fall on one single line, but they are different in their presentations, and they are different in their objective part. Fine. So once again, I would like to thank all the members from Govindamal College. My wife happens to be an alumni of Govindamal College. I must proudly acknowledge that here. Thank you very much, Madam Head of the Department, organizers, Dr. Uma and Serin Satya. Thank you so much. We'll meet again on some other day. God bless you all, my dear fellow participants.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir. Quite inspiring, informative, innovative. Very nice. We enjoyed frame to frame, syllable to syllable. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. I leave.
Thank you, sir. Here is a gentle reminder to the participants. The feedback form posted in the chat box will be open only for half an hour. So you are requested to fill it promptly, as only 100 certificates can be generated per day. It may take a week to generate certificates to all. Once again, I thank you one and all. And it's time to hit the road with your hope to meet you all in the future events. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Once again, thank you, Mamis. Thank you, Bhattri. Thank you, Serin Satya.